Okay, so I thought I'd make a little video about how hydroxychloroquine works. And to make it a little bit more interesting, I thought, why not base it around some of my favourite sci-fi films? So let's get our characters sorted out in this then. So, we need a cell. I would suggest the best planet for that is going to be the planet of Endor, home of the Ewoks. Now I say home, but personally I think the Ewoks somewhat infested the poor old planet of Endor, and certainly aficionados of the original Star Wars have a similar opinion that all the Ewoks really did was just be annoying and a precursor for even more terrible abominations like Jar Jar Binks and those stupid, cute, furry things that appeared in the later films. I don't even know their names. So, the Ewoks in this are the virus infesting Endor. And then, of course, we need some white cells. And the white cells can be the Death Star. So I know this is the wrong way around. The good guys appear to be the bad guys, and the bad guys in this appear to be the good guys. The Death Star appears to be the one that's trying to help and save us. But anyway, that's kind of how we present autoimmune conditions, isn't it? In the autoimmune conditions, the white cells for some reason appear to be the bad guys. And appear is the key word here. So, let's have a look at what is happening in so-called autoimmune conditions when we look from a long way away. We would see a perfectly happy planet like Endor or a cell being apparently destroyed for no reason by the Death Star, the white cells. What we need to do, science has said, is kill the Death Star, turn off the white cells. We need to stop them destroying that perfectly good planet. Now, this seems reasonable, but if you look more closely at this perfectly good planet, you'll see that there's an infestation of Ewoks or viruses. And just like the cell, these Ewoks are on the surface of the planet. So this is how the cell signals to the white cells, of course in this case the Death Star, that it is infected with viruses. What it does is it attaches part of the virus to something called an HLA antigen, expresses it on the surface of the cell, and the white cells then recognize that this is infected. So they kill this cell. But in autoimmune theory, there is no infection. And that's just it. It's a theory. So does this theory adequately explain what's going on? Well, first of all, within this theory, to explain why the autoimmune condition occurs in the first place, the theory states that there is something called molecular mimicry. In other words, it says that the body is invaded by some kind of pathogen, such as a virus, which then inexplicably confuses the immune system into thinking that part of the body is the same as part of the virus. So the body starts attacking the virus, building antibodies against the virus, and then these antibodies then, for some reason, also attack parts of the body.
Of course. This seems overly complicated. It makes far more sense that the immune system is simply attacking the virus or the pathogen that's hiding within a part of the body. Occam's razor says that this is the correct explanation. But what about the success that some of the treatments have with autoimmune disease? Well, the most successful of all drugs is hydroxychloroquine, a drug that is used through wide swathes of autoimmune disease such as lupus, rheumatoid arthritis, and many others. Then there are immunosuppressants, and these take various forms. But the key aspect of immunosuppressants is that they rarely, if ever, cure the disease. Rather, the disease bubbles on underneath. This, of course, makes sense. If the disease is caused by a virus or pathogen hidden deep within the body that the immune system is trying to get to, but in the process destroying those parts of the body, then turning down the immune system will cause less destruction, but will also mean that the pathogen persists. As a result, the patient will never truly cure. Autoimmune theory is unable to make any predictions. As such, it is a terrible theory. Whereas cryptoimmune, the theory that instead of the immune system attacking inexplicably its own body, it is attacking a hidden pathogen, makes predictions that are borne out in reality. The first is that wherever you find this condition, you will find high viral loads or pathogen loads within the body. The second is that if you correctly identify this pathogen and have a suitable antipathogenic agent, such as an antibiotic, it will cure the disease. So where does hydroxychloroquine come into this? And why is it such a valuable medication? Well, to understand that, we need to go a little bit more into what a virus does in order to reproduce. Viruses are known as obligate parasites. They require a host. They're obligated to find a host. Within the body, that host is a cell. And so the virus finds its way into a cell, where it then inserts its RNA or DNA into the genome of the cell. This effectively turns the cell into a zombie, a slave for the virus. And instead of the cell then doing its own function, it starts to produce more viruses. The virus, however, is at this point incomplete. All the components to make the virus are there. The RNA strands, the envelopes, and whatever enzymes and other things the virus requires, but they need to be recombined. This process occurs within something called lysosomes or endosomes within the cell itself. These can be understood as little bubbles. And within that bubble, the virus safely reforms before breaking out, destroying the cell and reinfecting new cells. Within these lysosomes or endosomes, it is very important that there is a highly acidic environment. Just like alien, the virus requires acidity to thrive. It has, if you like, acid blood. What hydroxychloroquine does is get into the cell. It not only gets into the cell, but the cells appear to adore hydroxychloroquine. They avidly bring it into the cell and hold on to it, resulting in a half-life within the body of months. No other medicine has such a long half-life. It really is a tonic for the cells. Within the cells, it then changes the pH in the lysosomes, making it impossible for the viral fragments to successfully recombine into a virus. So, what we have now is a new understanding of how so-called autoimmune disease functions. It is instead a disease of chronic, low-grade, pathogenic infection. Infection that lies not within the blood, what is known as sepsis or blood poisoning, but instead within the cells. And because the infection is within the cells, the immune system has one of two choices. It can either leave it or destroy the cells. For whatever reasons, humans have a very virulent immune system with a low tolerance of infection. As a result, the immune system often goes in causing excessive amounts of damage. And for that reason, immunosuppression may have a role to play. However, it is critical that we understand the true pathology of what is going on, because that way, we can find a cure.